just have a handful of announcements to make as we begin. Number one, please remember that this Wednesday, 6:30 p.m., we're having Dr. Desta, who's the head of a mission organization in Ethiopia that trains and sends out local missionaries to reach their own non-believing populace. It's a fundamentally awesome approach, and we have the opportunity to hear him in person. He's over in this area in the States to address some of the Ethiopian churches here, as well as other interested churches. And if you recall, my brother and his friend who are part of that, we're here at the end of April presenting that work. We get to actually hear the head of that mission directly himself. He, of course, is booked on Sundays with Ethiopian churches, but we get him on Wednesday night. So here at 6:30 on Wednesday. If you're able to come, I know we don't typically do something during the week, and so you're not used to having it kind of on your calendar, but please mark it down. Come if you can. It's a rare opportunity. 6:30 this Wednesday. Any questions? Yes?
I just wanted to make a note. It has been drawn into discussion by the deacons that this is a mission that our church might want to get involved with.
Okay.
And for that reason, also, I would just strongly recommend everybody be coming, so we know if we begin to develop a personal relationship with this gentleman. It's a fascinating outreach.
Yes.
I'd just like everybody to really understand what kind of an opportunity this is. So this is it's more than just a casual visit.
Right. It is kind of an actual introduction of mission to church. So just as according to my understanding, they are able to train and send out missionary families for a total of 400 a month. Like to send out missionaries from the States costs umpteen thousands per month. So that's why it's exciting to see what they're able to do. And if we're able to partner in some partial way, let's hear the man out, right? And see what the Spirit, Holy Spirit, might want to direct us toward. Yes.
And will they have prayer commitment, financial commitment prayer cards that evening as well for people individually?
You know, that's a good question. I need to track. You sent me an email, and it's on my desk, and I have been distracted. Sorry.
I will
get to that before Wednesday. Excellent. I'll find out. Right. And we have some visitors from out of town.
Oh,
yes. So just some people that some of you older or more settled congregants may recognize, and some of you newer folks won't. But if I could have Bill and Kate Goodrich, please.
Yeah, baby.
So Bill and Kate were part of this fellowship for a number of years and just treasured members of our fellowship, and then they up and moved to Wyoming. Hey, so, you know, we don't hold that against them too terribly bad.
No,
okay.
They're the reason that we're here.
I'm sorry?
They're the reason that Hank and I are here.
Oh, yes.
Ooh.
That is, and Kathy, yeah. We're glad to have you here. We also have Mark and Colleen here. Is it again? But we also have Mariah, right? Very good. Mariah is coming with us. So we're glad to have you all here this morning. Are there any other announcements that we need to highlight? Then let's prepare for worship.
Thank you.
stand and join with me for the call to worship from Revelation chapters 4 and 5. Behold, a throne stood in heaven, with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, and day and night they never cease to say,
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands, saying with a loud voice,
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.
And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying,
To him who sits on the throne, blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever.
And the four living creatures said, Amen.
Amen.
And the elders fell down and worshiped. Let us join in the worship of heaven together.
Amen.
very grateful for who you are. And we could have been brought to worship any of the other fickle and faltering gods that the rest of mankind follows. But we worship you, the one true God, the one who is of eternity, was, is to come, the one who is holy above all else, separate from all else, and absolutely and utterly perfect in every way. So we want to come and worship you for who you are. Let our hearts not be drawn away to lesser things, to gods or goddesses or whatever you want to call them, that are so much smaller and who lead us to destruction rather than lead us to life and hope and joy and peace now as well as forever. So we come and we offer our praise to you. May it be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the Lord.
And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not to be sorry. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor regarded man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, vindicate me against my adversary. For a while he refused. But afterward he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow bothers me, I will vindicate her, or she will wear me out by her continued coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says. And will not God vindicate his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I will tell you, he will vindicate them speedily. And nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?
So you'll understand why that reading was chosen later on in the service, but if we could have the children come forward at this time, let us cast our cares upon the Lord who cares for us. Excellent. Bring them all up. Is always to bring those things to him. So let us take a few moments to spend some time in prayer together. I will open, I will invite anyone else to voice a prayer before the Lord, and then we'll close together with the Lord's Prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are God who cares for us, that you are not just some holy, holy, holy God, transcendent above all, but that you are also our Heavenly Father who invites us into his lap to receive a hug and to tell him our troubles. And so we are so very grateful for who you are once again, and we want to kind of nestle into your embrace and to find the comfort and the reassurance that we have in your presence, even now today. So we want to come and we want to cast our cares on you.
Dear God, I pray for Donna. She just found out that they have a very aggressive cancer, and I pray that you will be able to find pathways and make it peaceful and comforting and healer, Lord. Help the doctors figure out the best course of action with the least damage, Lord.
Heavenly Father, I want to lift up Mariah's mother who was in a car crash. I don't know all the details, Lord, you do, and so we can offer that prayer to you, Lord, that you would watch over her life, Lord, that you would protect her body, but also protect her psyche because it's a traumatic event, Lord. So, Lord, so we just want to lift her before you right now. We also would pray that in this time of her distress that you would draw her heart toward you, that this will be a moment in which she reflects upon just how uncertain life is and how much we need to know you, Lord. So we pray that you would draw her close for healing both physically but also spiritually as well. And we just want to pray for Mariah as she's worried for her mom, Lord, that you would comfort her and direct her heart to you as well, in Jesus' name.
Dear Father, we thank you so much for what you're doing in Ethiopia through AIPM, and just really empower the director who is speaking to churches even today, Lord, prompt people's hearts, cause there to be a continued movement there, Lord, that people in America would respond to the amazing opportunity to send more missionaries, Lord. As the evil one desires to create disunity, when you are doing such a work, please give them good communication in the country, with all of the missionaries, train them up to be bold and very deeply knowledgeable of your word. And Lord, I thank you so much for the victory that Gospel for Asia has had recently. That's a very similar ministry, Lord, with Johan. Thank you that in Canada the court case was thrown out and that Gospel for Asia came. Fully have missionaries without the threat of the lawsuit.
Lord, thanks for bringing us together. Thank you for Billy King, for many others that have come together in this congregation to love you together. We just ask that revival would be in each of our hearts, so that it would start there, and that you would help our families and neighbors and co-workers and people we meet and work with, that they would see your love in us, and that we would see opportunities that we would take those divine appointments to reach out and proclaim who you are. How wonderful you are. Thank you for your grace. Help us to be true to you and not get distracted by everything out there that's not you.
Father, I just want to acknowledge and thank you for your sweet presence here this morning.
for little children that got up today and sang. It really touched my heart to see the enthusiasm in the older kids and the little sweet little ones singing praises to your holy name, Lord. That's how you want us to come to you as little children. That we come with nothing in our hands we bring, but simply to the cross we put. And it was exciting and touched my heart deeply to just see that. And I'm giving those kids a hug. Mm-hmm. Where I sit, and I think we all are. Thank you for the ministry of the music in our church and for those who step forward and partake in that. It's an awesome task, and they do it because they love you, and they love lifting your name up and encouraging us as we sing praises to your holy name. Thank you for all those who do the different things in this church, Lord. Thank you that Kathy came walking through the door today. I didn't get to see her, but praise God, I saw her from afar, and it rejoiced my heart to see that she was able to come. I just thank you, Lord, for the way you've been helping my husband, Lord. He's been able to breathe a little better now and feel a little better, and just praise you for each little thing you do for us, Lord, especially the little things. Lord, I just pray you'd be with Pastor John as he proclaims your word, Lord, that our hearts would be open and our minds, but not only our minds, but our souls. Speak to our souls, Lord. We love you and we worship you and we bow down before you. Your son's precious name. Amen.
Lord, there are many cares that weigh upon my wife's heart especially, but for all the family, there's some things going on that in the family that we need your help. They're beyond us, but we know that there's nothing that is beyond you. So you know what those cares are. I will not speak of them explicitly, but just I want to bring them to you and pray that you would enfold my wife as she has to bear the emotional weight that goes with it as well, Lord, that you would lift her up in Jesus' name.
What a joy, Lord, to be able to bring the burdens of our heart at the very same God that we express gratitude to. Just, it's such a living relationship, Father God. I'm so thankful for what you've done, what you're doing, and what you're doing in this church, Father God. Your hand of perfection is so obvious and evident. And the love is the joy of hearing the little ones and watching the older little ones grow in your nurture, Lord God, and then our care. It is just such a joy. Father, we thank you for knitting us together as a family. And we throw wide the doors of evangelism open, Lord God. We pray that you would bring others into our fold. And consider the impact that each and every person in this church has had on our church family. It just all fits together like a puzzle, like a beautiful puzzle, Father God. We're so thankful for your care. I do love also, Father God, both of our girls. Each one of them with their own challenge. Each of them important. And in many regards, they're stumbling. They create a churn. Viewpoint that as of yet, I just pray, Father God, that you move closer and closer to their heart. We begin to understand the criticality of their relationship with you, not just for their circumstances, Father God, but for their eternity. And I would pray, Father God, that you would continue to knock on each of their hearts. Amen.
Father,
we
thank you for
then let us close together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now I know JP referenced it in his prayer, but the little ones are always welcome. So don't worry about little squawks or nothing. Don't be stressed about that. If they holler, that's fine, right? So no worries. We love having them here. Also, I forgot to announce that we will receive a love offering on Wednesday for the mission. So if the Lord lays that on your heart to do so, there's no pressure, but we will receive one. Now if I could call for the ushers to receive the offering.
But
nonetheless. Let us look at Psalm 94. O Yahweh, God of vengeance, O God of vengeance, shine forth. Rise up, O judge of the earth. Repay to the proud what they deserve. O Yahweh, how long shall the wicked, how long shall the wicked exult? They pour out their arrogant words, all the evildoers boast. They crush your people, O Yahweh, and afflict your heritage. They kill the widow and the sojourner and murder the fatherless. And they say, Yahweh does not see. The God of Jacob does not perceive. Understand, O dullest of the people. Fools, when will you be wise? He who planted the ear, does he not hear? He who formed the eye, does he not see? He who disciplines the nations, does he not rebuke? He who teaches man knowledge, Yahweh, knows the thoughts of man, that they are but a breath. Blessed is the man whom you discipline, O Yahweh, and whom you teach out of your law, to give him rest from days of trouble, until a pit is dug for the wicked. For Yahweh will not forsake his people. He will not abandon his heritage. For justice will return to the righteous, and all the upright in heart will follow it. Who rises up for me against the wicked? Who stands up for me against evildoers? If Yahweh had not been my help, my soul would soon have lived in the land of silence. When I thought my foot slips, your steadfast love, O Yahweh, held me up. When the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul. Can wicked rulers be allied with you, those who frame injustice by statute? They band together against the life of the righteous and condemn the innocent to death. But Yahweh has become my stronghold and my God, the rock of my refuge. He will bring back on them their iniquity and wipe them out for their wickedness. Yahweh, our God, will wipe them out. When the cares of my heart are many, verse 19, does that speak to your soul? Is that a voice for your soul? So then, let us look at this psalm together, both at its setting and subject matter, yes, and then on to where that propels us, how that touches us in our own times that are becoming more and more disturbing. Because this psalm is disturbing, and the psalmist disturbed. And it's disturbing, taking the first half of that equation, not just because of the subject matter involved, but because of the very place of this psalm in the Psalter. Where is it located? You might not notice it at first, but the very place that God, through the compilers, placed this psalm in their prayer book speaks volumes and speaks loudly, and the voice is discordant. Because when you look at Psalm 94 itself, it is located where it's located in the larger book of Psalms. It stands in the midst of several songs, Psalms 93 through 99, a group whose driving motif and recurring theme is rejoicing in the justice and the kingship of God. It's what unites them all together. Yahweh reigns. The Lord reigns is the resounding cry we hear in Psalms 93, 96, 97, 99. And he is extolled as the king, or on his throne again in Psalms 93, 95, 98, 99. And he is proclaimed as the one who comes to judge the earth, as the Lord of all the earth in Psalms 96, 97, 98. Wow! That's stirring. That's inspiring. That's hallelujah. That is all right and in control. Near the very beginning of this great crescendo, we hear that pain and vocal complaint that seems to paint the very opposite picture. Instead of praising God for his kingship and justice, God's people are saying instead, in essence, where is the kingship and the justice? Instead of a joyous confidence that he is on the throne and will judge the earth, we hear the psalmist in the psycho-spiritual emotional depths, seemingly trying to rouse him. Rise up, O judge of the earth, verse 2. So what is going on here? Well, for one, this is what we're supposed to see. The disconnect. The glaring disconnect between what we know and profess and what we are experiencing right now, right? And see all around us. These two conflict, and we're supposed to see that conflict, which brings us to the Psalms again. The Psalter is the book of worship for God's people, where we are shown and learn how to bring everything to the Lord in prayer. And that includes bringing to him not only our praises and thanksgivings when things are all good, which is a very good thing to do and necessary, but not to be so emphasized that we consider that to be more spiritual. And so we paint plastic smiles on our faces, and you know what they look like, right? And look down on those whose lives may be racked with disillusionment and grief and pain. It also includes bringing these very songs of internal or external conflict into his presence. Yes, into his very throne room. And, as the children sang, casting them there. These two are equally, and necessarily so, our songs of faith.
Come on.
You see, we're not here for a feel-good moment. Come on. And biblical worship is not just some ethereal praise of God's virtues separate from our earthly existence. No, part of extolling his kingship and justice is seeing that kingship and justice continue to be revealed in our day-to-day lives. To see, as the center of the psalm reflects in verses 12 to 15, that blessing of rest from days of trouble when justice will return to the righteous. This is what we are called to. This is what we are to call for, to long to see, here it is, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, as the Lord himself taught us to pray. So yes, the psalm itself is disturbing. It rocks the boat. It shakes us up. And the psalmist himself is disturbed. Where is he located in society and vis-a-vis God? Things are not okay. And he is not okay. Life is not as it should be at all. And God seems not as he should be either. Where is the kingship? Where is the justice? Where is the basic concern for those who are being crushed? And yet as well, we remember that the psalmist is our model of faith, even here, perhaps a strange model of faith, perhaps a bit too conflicted and audacious. But maybe not. Our model of faith, not just in the encouragements of faith or the encouragements of praise, but also in the discouragements of life, going all sorts of wrong, and there seems to be no rescue or escape. How wrong has it gotten? How distressed is he? Very. But he doesn't give up faith. He still takes that distress to the Lord. He cries out for divine justice in the face of severe injustice, and that's where we ought to be drawn as well. And I say severe because the injustice we hear in this psalm is not our typical scenarios that we encounter, like, hey, I got a ticket for speeding when others were going faster than me and they didn't get caught. Or people are talking behind my back and ruining my reputation. Or I got overcharged on my bill. Or got substandard work done and I still was obliged to pay. Right? Those are all injustices, but they're not even close to what we're dealing with here. The injustices that are talked about here, the wrongs being perpetrated, are of the most extreme and deadly nature. It says in verse 5, they crush your people. It says, they afflict your heritage. To bring it into modern lingo, this is the oppression and suppression of true Christians simply because they're Christians. And this happens a lot, especially in other parts of the world under Muslim and communist regimes, though it's starting to happen more and more, little bit by little bit, even here. The camel's nose is in the tent. Soon will there be the whole camp. And even worse, verse 6, they kill the widow and the sojourner. They murder the fatherless. These are the weakest and most vulnerable in the system, whom those in power especially are most particularly charged to protect and defend. And instead they are taking steps to actually wipe them out, which is why God's justice at the close of this psalm will insist on him wiping them out. Verse 23, again, disturbing. But what needs to happen if push comes to shove, and there is no turn, we've talked about that a lot recently, is that very thing. Not from us, but from him. In fact, it gets worse. Because these aren't just instances of injustice committed by thugs and gangs, right? That the government and legislature and law enforcement are trying to apprehend and punish. No, this is injustice at the highest level. This is systemic abuse of the system. Verse 20 makes this especially clear. Can wicked rulers or a corrupt throne, or a throne of destruction, depending on your version, what it is and what it breeds, can wicked rulers be allied with you? This speaks to the governing authorities. Is God on the side of, or simply okay with, any nation, or any state or local government that actively does the kinds of things we see in verses 5 and 6? Crush believers. Kill the defenseless. We might look at what Russia's been doing in Ukraine, or what North Korea for so many years has systematically done, right? No, but it goes deeper. It spreads wider. It continues. Those, verse 20, those who frame injustice by statute. Ooh. This speaks of the legislative bodies. Those who make laws that promote evil. Okay, for example, looking across the world, the anti-blasphemy laws in Islamic countries that make it a crime punishable by death to say anything against Muhammad or the Quran, or even to be perceived as doing so. Not that you'd want to be intentionally offensive by any means, but that you not be killed for it at the very least. Be thankful, brothers and sisters, that our nation's ideals include the freedom of speech, along with the freedom of religion, at least thus far. Though they are disturbingly being eroded. But, and this one's been around a while, according to the Pakistan Penal Code, Article 295-C, quote, whoever by words, either spoken or written, or by visible representation, or by any imputation innuendo, or insinuation, directly or indirectly, defiles the sacred name of the holy prophet shall be punishable with death or imprisonment for life and shall also be liable to fine, unquote. Innuendo and all those sorts of things can be horribly abused without any cause. Or in its simpler form, in case in the Criminal Law Amendment Act of 1986, by the way, our legislatures at the various levels are entertaining things that are going to be doing similar things about innuendo or this, that, and the other. The penalty for contempt of the Holy Prophet is death and nothing else, unquote. And so you see how, living under that sentence, Christians are, and there are Christians in that land, and other Islamic lands, right? They're systematically suppressed, terrorized, and cowed into silence. What kinds of nations are these that crush your people? Right? Verses 5 and 6. But we don't have to go as far as that. Because this same question also touches our own nation as well, as we're seeing more and more. There's the increasing laws that will now strip parents of their rights, or one parent of his or her rights, if they do not affirm the gender confusion and thus gender transition, hormonal and surgical, of their child. By law. Injustice by statute. And there's certainly the obvious and egregious and applauded practice of abortion. We not only continue to have the government funding of Planned Parenthood, for example, which makes much of its money by promoting and performing abortions, whether those are directly funded or not, funding the organization funds the practice. But now also the military is going to cover the cost of service members and their families getting abortions or traveling to get an abortion in states that curtail the practice. Certain states, like California, are moving to cover those costs and advertising it as something that Jesus himself would support. This is something of almost sacramental status in our secular culture, both a right as well as a right, an R-I-G-H-T as well as an R-I-T-E, touted by all the elites of culture and by so many in political power. I point you to the recent letter out of Congress that I referenced last week. Even, unsurprisingly but nonetheless appallingly, the United Church of Christ, right, a major Christian denomination, in its general synod that met earlier this month, has come out parroting this political correctness when it denounced the Dobbs decision that overturned Roe and declared that, quote, abortion is healthcare, unquote, and claimed that, quote, forced birth is an act of sexual violence, unquote. As a culture and a nation even seeped into the church, a nation, by the way, not of executive fiat, but of studied laws, that's who we are supposed to be, we have now redefined what is undeniably a human baby by labeling it reproductive rights. And we have dismissed and disparaged the natural and wonderful process of bringing a new life into the world and called it a stigma and burden to be rid of. And we need to ask ourselves, what kind of a nation is this that murders the fatherless and celebrates it? What kind of nation are we before God? Disturbed? Distressed? We ought to be, but we're not left there. That's part of the why of this psalm, because this psalm drives us to certain particular applications. And that's what I really want to emphasize here, because the psalms are all about response. Responding out of our life circumstance and directing that to God. So when we think about how this psalm applies to our lives, there are three P's, as a mnemonic device, three P's I want us to keep in mind. Number one, persevere. Number two, pray. Number three, prepare. Right? So application number one, persevere. And I would say persevere in three virtues. As the Apostle Paul concludes his central and critical chapter in that first letter to the Corinthians, in chapter 13, verse 13. So now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. I want to pick up from his cue there and say we need to persevere in faith, hope, and love. Right? Faith that God is the place of our rest. As it says in the psalm, to give him rest from days of trouble, verse 13. That God is still on the throne. That he stands above all the other wicked rulers mentioned in verse 20. Thus the appeal in verses 1 and 2. And yes, that God is the one to whom we are to direct our distress, and under whose sovereign governance we are to direct our ways. Hope. The hope that we have in this one who is above all, this one to whom we may appeal and who loves to hear and answer the appeals of his people, even as we must content ourselves with the conundrum of genuine faith, best expressed by Daniel's three friends in Daniel chapter 3. And I want to just read a few verses from there, beginning halfway through verse 15. Daniel chapter 3. Nebuchadnezzar, by the way, the same king we're dealing with in Jeremiah. He says this, "But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace, and who is the God who will deliver you out of my hand?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." Right? But specifically, as we approach this psalm from our present context, it is the hope primarily of the gospel which is the true hope for our world. The hope that it's always been, because that's how our Lord may most powerfully and mercifully act on our behalf, on behalf of those in distress, and in those causing that distress. Just as the Apostle Paul in his before and his after. And it's the same hope that is still in our current distress. The details of that distress may change, the theology does not. The hope does not. And we need to lay hold of that hope ourselves and be free with sharing that hope in whatever way we can, with whomever we can, as the Lord so prompts and guides. As Paul said, so now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. And this is where we need to hear the words of our Lord, to really hear them and take them to heart, when he says in Luke chapter 6, 27 and 28, "Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. For when we do this," he goes on to say, verse 35, "you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil." Wow. Let that sink in. I know I need to too. Because our tendency is to lash out. But that can never be our way. Even in the Old Testament, as exampled in these Psalms, the example of the psalmist was to continue to love and do good, even while he thrust the demands of that continued and egregious injustice back into the hands of the kingly judge in prayer. For example, before those harsh and uncomfortable words in Psalm 109, and that psalm, by the way, is one of the worst. Look at it later. Right? David first expressed this, verses 4 and 5. In return for my love, they accuse me, but I give myself to prayer. So they reward me evil for good and hatred for my love. I mean, this is what he practiced and what we must practice too if we are to image David's greater son and Lord. So this love your enemies, this we can never lose sight of or ever cease from doing. It is our distinctly Christian calling. The refusal to take revenge into our own hands, but instead let our hands be vessels of mercy. If your enemy is hungry, Romans 12:20, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. This is where the supernatural Christian life really shows up, because such response is so visibly supernatural. Just try holding back your fist when someone knocks you over the head, right? Try holding back your tongue when someone spews vile at you. Persevere in loving and doing, always making sure to repay evil with good rather than tit for tat. Because that is what our Lord calls us to. But there is more that we are called to do, as boldly exemplified for us here, and that's application number two. Pray. I mean, that's what the psalm is. It's a prayer. Pray for them and pray against them. Because certainly, we are to pray for their salvation, as we always ought to do, and we need to apprehend this or reapprehend this anew. It needs to be an underscored given in our lives in this distress. There is no one who is too far from the grace of God. Again, just ask the Apostle Paul. And while there is life, there is hope, as I often say, and which is often the base and the springboard of my continued prayers. But also, certainly, pray against them, as we are exampled here. Yes, we want to see their salvation, but we also want to see justice and to see right. Yes, we long for them to be saved and thus changed, but barring that, we long for God's righteousness to topple all this wickedness. That's why the psalmist prays, and why we can and must pray for God's justice, for his vengeance. What the psalmist ties together as part of the same basic concept in verses 1 and 2. O God of vengeance, shine forth, rise up, O judge of the earth. Coupled with what I just talked about with persevering in love, this is something that we are to cry out to God for, because it's part of what it means to be joined to God in covenant, that he is joined to us and to our cause. In fact, we even see this very thing surprisingly, and this is where I'm going to bring in what we heard earlier in the service, enjoined on us by our Lord himself. This is Luke 18. We might not think that Jesus would have anything to do with these pleas for justice against systemic injustice, and yet he does. And Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they always ought to pray and not lose heart. He said in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man, so he's a corrupt judge. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, give me justice against my adversary. For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says. And here's the punchline. Will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night. Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, and here's the focus of when it comes, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? Will he find us pleading to him for his justice right now? As I said before, this psalm describes systemic injustice at the highest level. And as such, it is humanly unstoppable and unpunishable, which is why the psalm begins where it does, verse 1, O Yahweh, God of vengeance. He, realistically, is the only one we can go in such times. And it is he in this capacity, that we are supposed to go to in such times. Vengeance for us is a bad thing. Because we are too small to understand and undertake the demands of justice in truth and in righteousness. But God is not too small. And vengeance rightly belongs to him. Romans 12, 19, the one right before it says, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. It says this, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord, which allows us to be able to love our enemies because we know that justice belongs to him. And as we are directed to hear, we are to look to him for his vengeance and cry out to him for his justice and for his justice in the here and now, because it says, verse 2, rise up, O judge of the earth. But there's one more P that we're not used to thinking about, perhaps. Well, we most certainly need to. And that is application number 3. Prepare. And especially, prepare for suffering. But on the way, remember the faith, hope, and love, these three, right? Prepare with faith, build up, shore up, strengthen in faith, which is part of what we are doing right here and why it is so important. And prepare with hope, the hope of the gospel. We need to be instilling that deeper in ourselves and ready ourselves to be more ready to give an answer for the hope that is in us. As it says in 1 Peter chapter 3, beginning in verse 14, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. Why does he say that? Because we are afraid, and we are troubled. But in your hearts, he says, honor Christ the Lord as holy. Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ, which is happening more and more, by the way, may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that be God's will, and that's what we live in, than for doing evil. Or as the Apostle Paul requests, and it should be our request as well, Colossians 4, 3 and 4, Sandy, you brought this up last week, I think it was. Pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak, or as he says it at the end of Ephesians 6:20, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. And also, yes, prepare with love, and one particular side of that is going to entail more and more as our culture and country and so many other countries of the world are spiraling quicker and farther away from any friendship or friendliness toward the Lord or the things of the Lord, particularly the gospel that calls us sinners. And then calls us to the cross. It's something we're not used to thinking about. We've been happily lulled away. We don't want to think about it, but we must. We like to think that we should be exempt from it, but we're not. It's actually promised by Jesus himself. We are to love our enemies, yes, but our enemies will often not return that love, but instead will return it with abuse, which brings us to the main preparation that we need to steel ourselves for, and that is we need to prepare, brothers and sisters, for suffering ourselves. If they persecuted me, Jesus said, John 15:20, they will also persecute you. For most of modern Western Christianity, we're not ready for this. Such things are far from us. We have been lulled by our comforts and freedoms into a careless stupor. But we must not allow ourselves to continue in this sleep any longer. The world is churning. Who knows? With all that's going on right now, with all the apprehension and uncertainty that brings, what's going on with all that? What's going to happen with all this? What are we going to do with all that? Particularly with the ever-increasing anti-Christian sentiment, both in the public forum and judicially / legislatively. And what's all that going to mean for us? Who knows but that the experience of the psalmist and of our real-life brothers and sisters in other lands right now might come home to our own home as well. Are we ready? You see, this psalm not only speaks for those who are currently suffering such things, it must also and equally serve as preparation for us. And especially also, hate to break it to you, Judah, and any Aubrey, etc. Especially also for our children.
Yes.
To suffer for Jesus. It's part of our calling. Not only are we ready, are we helping our children to be ready to face what lies ahead, to truly own the faith and love the Lord more than absolutely anything else. To be able to stand in gentleness and defy the prison, the knife, and the flame in order to confess Christ before men, that we might hear him confess us before the Father in heaven. This must begin to be our song as well. So we look around us today and we might wonder if God is really on the throne and if there is a God of justice, and that is actually an appropriate thing to wrestle with. The people in scriptural days were not oblivious to these struggles either. In fact, that is part of the reason it's here to force us in faith to look at these issues in reality, but also to train our eyes back to seeing the higher reality above it all. Yes, we look all around us, and where is God's kingship? Where is his justice? Why isn't he acting? Why won't he act? The same cry that might echo in our hearts, it's the same cry that was on the psalmists back in the days when the scriptures were first written and compiled. Even here in the outlay of these psalms of praise for his kingship and justice. Smack dab, right at the beginning, we have this discordant note. And it's here for us to build us up in the faith and also to train us where to direct us in our struggles. So again, look all around us. Yes, it's disturbing. And we are disturbed. But when we look at this psalm in the Psalter and the psalmist in this psalm, it is disturbing. And he is disturbed. And that's why it's here. That's why it's important for us to come here or to be brought here, because it draws us back to him. Not that the distress is resolved, but that we might bring our distress to him. We learn to come there, we learn to stay. stay there even when it remains distressing. We may rest in him. Because even as we come, even as we see the psalmist come, there is that uncanny movement from complaint, rise up, there at the beginning, to confidence. He will, there at the end. That is the movement that the Holy Spirit draws his saints when we learn to come to him. But where do we go from there? Right? Three takeaways as we move back into the fray. Again, the primary rule of the preacher, if I remember from J. Vernon McGee, I think it was. First, you tell them, so I don't follow this rule most of the time. Today, I kind of. First, you tell them what you're going to tell them. Then you tell them. Then you tell them what you just told them. Right. Where do we go from there? Three takeaways as we move back into the fray. Persevere, right? Persevere in faith, hope, and love. Pray. Pray both for them, salvation, and against them, against the wickedness. And three, prepare for ourselves for suffering, and especially prepare for our children to be able to suffer while continuing to stand faithful for Christ. We don't want to see that for our kids. That's not up to us. Will we be faithful to walk and also to train? Christ himself proclaimed, Matthew 5, verses 11 and 12, blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your encouragement that you bring to us in our discouragement. Help us to walk more faithfully after you, because we truly do want to image your life through our lives. So we ask you, pour out your Holy Spirit afresh on each and every one of us here. We need to be filled with your Holy Spirit in a more mighty way, Lord. Mighty in word and mighty in deed. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us turn in our hymnals to that wonderful hymn of solace and encouragement to us in our distress. His eye is on the sparrow, hymn 624, please stand.
My heart be lonely.
hearts, may Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yahweh make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May Yahweh lift up his face upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
May the grace of Christ our Savior and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Spirit be with us. May the grace of Christ our Savior and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Spirit be with us. Please join us for some fellowship and refreshment.
Thank you.